she just said, you know, I said, well, how does it look? And she said, it doesn't look good. And to me, that meant this was the day. This was the day my body was going to give up on me.
What's happening, everybody? It's episode 55 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, the only place to hear the best stories from the best martial artists, like today's guest, Sensei Andrea Harkins. I'm the founder here at Whistlekick, but listeners know me better as the host, and my name is Jeremy Lesniak. Whistlekick, in case you don't know, makes the world's best sparring gear as well as great apparel and accessories, all for practitioners of the traditional martial arts. I'd like to welcome our new listeners and thank all of you returning fans. If you're not familiar with our products, you should check out everything we make, like our baseball caps. These are fairly new for us, and they've been selling like crazy. Lots of pictures of these and our other stuff over at whistlekick.com. If you want to check out other past episodes of the podcast, those are at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. And while you're on our website, go ahead and sign up for the newsletter. We offer great content to subscribers, and it's the only place to find out about upcoming guests for the show. Now, let's move on to the episode. It's episode 55, and we're joined by Sensei Andrea Harkins, a martial artist and writer from the sunny state of Florida. We talk a lot about Sensei Andrea's time in the arts and her perspective on the martial arts as someone who came to it as an adult, which is unlike most of our guests. As usual with our guests, Sensei Andrea goes deep and really opens up with some personal and private stories. I took a lot of inspiration from her words, and I think you will too. Sensei Andrea, welcome to Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio.
Thank you. I am so excited to be here. I'm really thrilled. Thank you for having me.
Oh, well, it's an honor to have you. This is going to be a lot of fun. So let's get going. You know, as you said, you've listened to the show, so you know how we start every episode. Tell us how you got started in the martial arts.
I have a wonderful story about getting started. It basically was not my idea at all, which is a little bit different than most people. Most people think, I want to learn a martial art, let me go try one. I was newly married about a year, and my husband had always had an interest in martial arts, had taken a little bit of martial arts when he was younger. And he decided it would be a great thing for us to do together. So I wasn't so sure about it. I had a little trepidation about going, and I had never actually seen martial arts up close and personal. I had seen it on TV or in movies or whatever, but I never been to a dojo, never been to a class or school or anything like that. So we did go, and it was in a community center, so it was reasonably priced. It was not too far from home. It had a great instructor and and assistant instructors, and it was a large class with lots of people. And I walked in there, and it was here in Florida, which is a very warm state, as you know. And I don't think the air conditioning even worked. I don't even think it had air conditioning there. You know, this was old school, 26 years ago. And we went in, and everybody was waiting before class or starting to stretch, and that seemed okay. And we did some stretching with the class, and then we sort of sat on the sidelines. And he said, just sit and watch for a few minutes. And as we're sitting on the sidelines, there were quite a few black belts in the class. They were performing katas and forms, and there was some board breaking, and people were yelling. And I remember sitting there with this dust kind of swirling around and these sweaty people and yelling and breaking boards. And I just thought to myself, there is no way I'm ever doing this. Absolutely no way. And I still laugh about it because I remember it so vividly thinking, no. But like anything, you have to give things a chance, right? The first time is never the full story. So we did continue to go maybe once or twice a week. More than not, it was once a week. That's all we could sort of fit into our schedules at the time. And I started to like it. I started to really like it. I felt empowered. I started feeling more confident about myself. And I found it very interesting. You think that these black belts just break boards or yell or do a nice kata. just because they know how to do it. You forget that they start from day one just like you as a beginner. So I started from day one and started to build on it and realized how they were doing these things and had great instructors, like I said. So I really got into the martial arts because of my husband, but I stuck with it because of how much I learned to enjoy it. And it was such a personal challenge for me. It was very funny because there were parts of me that I never knew about until I tried a martial art. And in those first classes, I realized how very focused and intense I was. And I remember the instructor pointing me out many times as I was a white belt or a yellow belt to other students who were higher ranked to say, look at the focus and intensity in this person. And honestly, I never knew I had that. So there were lots of lessons, lots of personal lessons that I learned when I started martial arts, and I stuck with it because it fit me. It ended up being something that was right for me. And I loved it from then on out.
Wow. So here we are, here you are, you know, you're in this class and you're discovering something that just clicks for you that you'd never experienced before. Did you play sports growing up, or did you have any other passions that maybe were a little different?
That was really the next point I was going to make. I was never athletic, or I didn't think I was. I had some athleticism, but I never pursued it, first of all, because I didn't have the confidence to. I never felt that I was really good enough to be on a team or play a sport or pursue something. And I never felt athletic. This was the first time in my life, and I was 26 years old when I started, that I realized I had potential, that I realized I was better than I thought I was, that I had a lot in me that I had never explored before athletically. In fact, it was around that same time that I started exercising more with weights and jogging and doing other things that were sort of athletic, physical fitness, that I had never really done before. And ever since then, I still combine martial arts with other athletic activities or physical fitness that I enjoy doing. I ran 5Ks, which I never knew I could even run a mile, you know, but I finally thought to myself, hey, if I can break boards or if I can fight with somebody, I can certainly run a mile. And that's what it taught me about athleticism is I think there's an athlete in everyone. There's something athletic in everyone anyway. You just need to find it. But martial arts was a great way to catapult me into a more athletic person. And I've been like that ever since. Still to this day, I'm 52 years old. I still practice the martial art. I still work with weights and I still do aerobic exercises. I do it all because it all clicks together for me, thanks to my beginning in martial art.
Wow. Yes. The other thing I wanted to go back to was you painted a pretty solid visual for us of that first time you walked into the school at the, you say it was a community center. And I could imagine you on the sidelines there watching everyone before class and doing all of these things that probably seemed pretty odd in that moment. And I was getting the impression that maybe you felt overwhelmed. Is that accurate?
Yeah, I absolutely did. It was, there were women there too. So a lot of people ask me, well, was it mostly men? It was mostly men, but there were other women. And it was overwhelming because, as I said, I had never seen this up close before. I had never seen people sparring or fighting up close. You know, boxing had been on TV or people watched fights like that, but I'd never really seen anybody sparring either. So all of this was new. That really frightened me, the sparring. And it was all very new to me. And when I learned the first kata, I always tell people that the first form, pattern, kata, whatever you call it, the first one that you learn is the hardest one because it makes absolutely no sense. Why am I turning my leg this way? Why am I punching with this arm and looking that way. I mean, it's just, it is simple, but it's so difficult. So all of those things, yeah, they were overwhelming, but as I progressed, I learned to just take one class at a time or one step at a time. And that's what helped me get through that and not worry about it so much.
That's great. And I can totally see myself there, you know, watching you taking this journey that, you know, I've taken and most of the listeners, of course, have taken. So I really thank you for sharing that with us. But I know, you know, we're going to get into the fact that you're a writer as we go later on. So I know you've got stories, and that's what we're all about here on Martial Arts Radio is stories. And I'm sure you've got a bunch of them. So I'd like you to tell us your best martial arts story.
Yeah, I do have a bunch. I have a bunch. But I'm going to tell you one of my favorites, and I've told it before. And the reason I tell it over and over is because you can never hear this kind of story too much. It's really a story about believing in yourself and a story about confidence and a story about mindset. When I was testing for my green belt, I was always very nervous about tests, always very nervous. My husband would ask me, why are you so nervous? Why are you so anxious? They would not ask you to test if you weren't ready. I know what you know, and I'm not that upset about it. But still, I was always very, very nervous. So for our green belt test, I made sure I knew what I needed to know, that I could execute it and perform, and whatever was going to be asked of me, I had practiced. I felt good about it. Even on the drive there, I was a little nervous that day, but I felt good. So the exam or the test, there were, again, lots of people testing at the same time. And it was in the community center, and they had bleachers. So there were people there watching the students. And since there were so many students, some testing for just beginning belts, some were testing for higher belts. So everybody had family or friends there in the stands. And I went through the test. I did everything. I felt really good. Everything they asked me to do, I knew what it was. I didn't forget anything. I don't remember making any big mistakes. I felt really good. And at the end, they always, everybody kind of goes into one area and sits down. And they were getting ready to do that. So I felt like I did this. I got through my green to my green belt. And I heard the sensei call my name up. And I thought to myself, why is he calling me? We're done. We're finished, aren't we? We're finished. And he came up and I saw that he had some boards. And I thought to myself, my stomach. Oh, I can't even tell you how I felt when I saw him pull out a board. I'd never broken one before, not in class, nowhere. So he pulled out this board, and it was a 1-inch board. And he pulled out another board, and it was another 1-inch board. And he put the 2 1-inch boards together. And I'm just looking at him thinking, what is he doing? I don't know how to do this. And he said, okay. And he was just talking to me in a low voice. And he said, Andrea, you're going to do a jump front kick and break the boards. And I'm sure I whined a little bit and said, I never did this before, but there was no time for that. And people were watching. So he says, just do the jump front kick and kick the board with the ball of your foot in the middle and just do it. So I'm sitting there and I thought to myself, okay, do what he says. Do what he says. I'm trying to talk to myself. Just do what he says. So I get myself ready. I jump up. It was a pretty good jump, but the execution wasn't all that great. And my foot just bounced off the board, And I remember thinking, oh my goodness, everybody's looking at me. Everybody sees this. What am I going to do? He said, Andrea, just do it again and break the boards. So I'm trying to change my mind about how I was thinking again. Okay, he said, break the boards. Just, you know how to do this kick. Just put your foot on the board. Yeah, I don't know what was going through my mind. So I jump up the second time. My foot bounces off again. Well, now I'm embarrassed and humiliated and feeling just awful, like I wish I could crawl under a rock. But there's no rocks. There's no big rocks. There's no boulders in there that I can get behind. So I tell myself, and this is the whole key to the story, I finally told myself I could do it. That was the one thing I hadn't told myself. I had told myself, he wants you to do it, you know how to do this kick, but I never told myself those first two times, I can do this. I can do this. I've done other things that were difficult. I know how to do this kick. So I realized on the third try that I hadn't told myself the one thing that I really needed to tell myself. I had not given myself the gift of confidence. I didn't tell myself that I could do it. I had told myself that he wanted me to do it, or I know he tells me I can do it, or everybody's looking at me, I should do it. But it wasn't until that third time when I really was under the gun and had no other idea what to do that I allowed myself to believe that I could do it. And I tell people that that was the easiest board break I've ever done in my life. That third try, all I did was change my mindset. All I did was change my negative thought to positive thought, and was able to break through because of that. And today, that's the very thing that I use to practice in my life when I have difficulties or obstacles. It's just that one little reminder that I can do it. And so that's one of my favorite stories, because it set the stage for who I am as a martial artist, as a martial arts writer, as a motivator. That was the first time that I allowed myself to believe in myself. And that's why it's such an important story, not just for me and not just for martial artists. I've used this story when I talk to groups at churches and other women and different people. And when I pull out the two boards to show them what it was, they all gasp, because they look at it as non-martial artists and think that's impossible. As martial artists, we know, as long as we use good technique, that we can do it. But it's a great story for everyone, because it just shows the power of the mind.
Yeah. So you still have those boards.
I have those boards. Yeah.
That's great. So there's a lot of symbolism in there, of course. And
so much. Yeah.
And I think most martial artists that have been training for more than a few years have had the opportunity to break a board or two, some far more than others. I've trained at schools where it's been a lot higher of a priority, whereas others, it comes out only at testings, such as you experienced there.
Right.
But I think it's a great symbol, because it's such a transitional point. The first time that you break a board, to be on the side of never having done it just feels like the most daunting thing in the world, even if it's one board. And of course, yeah. I mean, you're an instructor now. I don't know if you break in your curriculum, but I'm sure you've seen. Okay, you do. So you get to see, just as I do, and just as I'm sure a lot of the listeners do, other people as they step up for their first opportunity to break a board, and the range of emotion that comes through, be it fear or terror or excitement or some combination of all of them.
Right.
And then you get through that. And then on the other side, you realize, oh, I can do that.
Yeah.
So
it's amazing.
It is amazing. Absolutely.
So I love the story. And I like to share it with, as I said, martial artists and non-martial artists, because everybody can relate to breaking through a barrier. Everybody can relate to having some blockade put up in front of them and having to figure out how to break through it. So it really is very symbolic.
Yeah. Absolutely. So a lot of the guests that we have on the show started martial arts at, you know, right out of the womb, practically. But you started a little bit later in life, so you know what your life was before martial arts. And a lot of our guests have to think of this question in a hypothetical sense. So I'd like you to compare what your life looked like before martial arts and after, and imagine, had you never stepped into the community center that day, what do you think your life would be like now?
Right. You know, I am a writer, and I actually wrote a blog about this And I called it Martial Arts Saved Me. Not that they saved me from drugs or, you know, something crazy, but they really saved me from myself. They really saved me from not having a lot of confidence. There was a point in my life where I would never want to speak in public or be interviewed by somebody. There was a point when I never believed that I had any special purpose or talents or skills. And this was all before martial arts. I felt like an average person. And I just went through every day without a lot of goals. In fact, there were many times in my earlier years where I couldn't think of a goal. My husband used to ask me, well, what are your goals? What do you want to do? And I would say, I don't know. That was the trite answer I would throw out all the time because I didn't have the focus and I didn't have the ambition and I wasn't sure where to go. So the reason I say martial arts saved me is because I would have never become the person I am today if not for my journey into martial arts. I wasn't confident back then or tenacious or positive. And I know if I had continued being that way today, I'd be struggling with so many life and health issues. I wouldn't have the motivation that I have. I know this because I look around. I see other women my age who are having difficulties with health issues, who are having difficulties with family issues or whatever it might be, physical fitness. I don't have that because of martial arts. I think that I've been able to push the negative from my life and replace it with things like hope and insight and positivity. And I didn't have that before. I was a negative person. I think everybody is sort of predisposed to negativity. It's so easy to go the negative route. It could be something as simple as it's a rainy day today. And seeing that as a negative thing, as opposed to a day where maybe you could stay inside and get a lot of work done, or a day when you could take a nap or go see a movie, or maybe it's just not such a bad thing. Before martial arts, I would have seen it as the bad thing, the negative thing, the dreary day. Why is it raining? After the martial arts, I could see it for what it was. And, you know, I have so many martial art friendships. There are so many people I trust and admire now. I am the person I am, and I'm so grateful for it. I'm a positive person. I've transformed my life into motivating and inspiring others. It really is my mission and my purpose. I am a martialist, but what I've done is taking everything I've learned, the physical parts, but also the mental part, and created the person that I've always wanted to be, created the type of person I used to look up to myself, the one that I would point to and think, I wish I was like her. Now I am like her. I am her. And that all of that I attribute to martial arts. They helped me to walk toward being the person that I always wanted to be, to strive and to work hard. And all of those amazing things happened to me because of my martial art practice.
Wow, that's great. And that's so powerful. And I really hope people hone in on that. I think a lot of us are, you know, because we started really young, we take for granted some of these wonderful benefits that the martial arts bring to us. And here you have a much, I would say, better perspective, a better ability to compare what life is before and after martial arts, and thus value martial arts. So
yeah.
I appreciate that perspective, and thank you for sharing it. Now, a lot of what we've talked about so far, you're welcome. A lot of what we've talked about has been more high points. So let's take it a little bit in the other direction. And I'd like you to talk about a low point in your life that your martial arts experience or training helped you overcome.
And again, I have several of these actually. I'm going to talk about one, and later we're going to talk about some of my writing, and I'll share with you some of the little bit briefly some of the stories that I'm going to include in a book. But
sure.
One of the low points that I talk about. Because being a female martial artist, not that I, you know, gender is not really important in martial arts. There's no gender involved. It's just the perspective of the student that might be different, a woman and a man. They're taught the same way, but their perspectives are different. One of the things that is obviously different about women and men generally is having children, right? Women have the babies.
Right.
So a woman martial artist, female and a male, are going to have that different. When I was pregnant with my third child, I have four. When I was pregnant with my third child, at about my fifth month of pregnancy, I went into labor, and I didn't realize that I had some slight complications and went to the hospital. When I went to the hospital, they did an examination and they said, "You are now admitted." And I was admitted to the hospital, and I never had a chance to go home and get my toothbrush or my clothes or anything like that. I was just admitted. And I'll tell you up front that I was there for 6 weeks. But the day I was admitted, they took me to the room and they said, "Listen, we're really sorry to tell you this, but this pregnancy is basically doomed. Your body's not able to hold this pregnancy. You're in labor and we're going to try to stop it." And they gave me some medication, and it was something that gave me double vision and a severe headache. And I was really scared. I was really, really worried about this. I had some miscarriages previously, and so I did sort of believe that this was a doomed situation. And they would come in the day, each day, each morning, and say, "Look, it's probably going to happen soon, and you're going to have to deliver this baby, but it's not going to survive. We just want you to be prepared to know that this is going to happen." And at first, I believed them. At first, I believed everything that they said, because they're the professionals, they're the medical professionals, and they see life through medical professional eyes. This is what they do. They test, they examine, they come up with reasons and theories, and they share them with you. And at first I accepted it, and I was devastated, of course. And one day I went for an ultrasound, because they did ultrasounds frequently, just trying to check the status. Every day, every half a day, they would do an ultrasound. And I remember the woman who did the ultrasound one day looking at it, and she's not supposed to share what it showed, but she just said, "You know," I said, "Well, how does it look?" And she said, "It doesn't look good." And to me, that meant this was the day. This was the day my body was going to give up on me. And I was scared, and I started crying. I was, you know, crying. And the doctor came in, and he said, why are you crying right now? And I said, "Well," she looked at it and she saw this. And he said, That's not true. That what she said is not accurate." And so I realized right then, it's not accurate. What are they saying? There is no accurate when it comes to your own body and your own life. What's accurate is what you believe and what you see. And that was a turning point, like breaking through that board. For my green belt exam, this was a turning point for me to decide that I'm going to change the way I think about this. I'm going to change the way I look at this. I'm going to use my martial art mindset here and decide that, first of all, I'm going to be positive about this. No matter what happens, if this baby is not meant to survive, I'll accept it. But if there's any chance that I can do anything at all to save this child, I'm going to do it. I'm going to give 100%. There's my martial art mindset right there. I'm going to give 100%, and I'm going to do everything I can, because I feel this child moving inside of me, and I can't believe that its life is going to end like that. So I changed my mind. I changed my mind about everything. And I decided I would never listen to what they would say again. And that was the martial art mindset. And then I started using my martial art memories and my martial art training, such as envisioning myself breaking through a board, such as performing katas when I was scared in my head, thinking about them, meditating. I wasn't allowed to get up. I had to lay flat for as many days as I could. And I had to change the way my mind worked. And I used martial arts. That's how I got through it. And after 6 weeks in the hospital, they allowed me to go home. I still hadn't delivered the baby that they were so certain was going to come prematurely and not survive. I went home on bed rest for another 4 months, and I delivered a healthy baby full term, almost 15 years ago. So that was one of the lowest points in my life, but one of the most amazing times when I was able to change my mindset and work through it. Now, I'm not saying that it'll work for everybody. I'm not saying that somebody with an illness can wish it away. You can't, but you can change your perspective. And like I did, I was willing to accept what was going to happen. And I was also willing to work 100% to do whatever I could that it wouldn't. And that was the story.
And I think that that's the key there, that word work. Everything I've ever read about cancer patients says that one of the major divisions between those that survive and those that don't is that the stubborn ones, the ones that question every decision, the ones that do their own research, that are essentially doing whatever they can to fight, to gain knowledge, to suggest alternative treatments, the ones that are a pain in the butt to the doctors are the ones mm-hmm. that have the higher rates of recovery.
Yeah.
And you took a similar track. You shifted from accepting what the doctors told you to, in the way that you could, having that warrior, that Budo spirit, to take it on as a challenge, as a battle. And
yes, exactly. Exactly.
Without attempting to trivialize anything down to a single word, you won.
Yes.
What you wanted happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there's something really glorious in there.
Yeah, that is one of the keys about positivity. It gives you the opportunity to win. It doesn't mean you're going to. It doesn't mean you're going to overcome every battle and not come out with some kind of scar. But it does mean that you've opened up the opportunity to win, if that opportunity exists, if it's there, if there's just a small bit of it out there, you've opened up the opportunity to it. And that's a martial art mindset, and that's a warrior spirit.
Yeah, without a doubt. Please go ahead.
And it was a warrior spirit that I didn't know I had. That was another turning point in my life that's helped me become who I am today, because I didn't know I was that warrior woman.
When did you realize that? Was that after this experience with the pregnancy?
I think this was one of the biggest moments. It was during it. When I changed my mind and I started wondering how I could explore it differently to make it positive experience, to work diligently in some manner to try and control some of it. And I think it was during that time when I just realized the power of the mind and what it meant to believe in yourself. And allow yourself to try. Some people are just afraid to try. The fear of trying, you know, some people would just let it go and say, you know what, fine, it's over. Let me just get over this. Let me just stop it now and not do anything about it. Let me just let it the worst happens, so I can just move on past it, forget about it. But, you know, to face it is a different story. And when you face things head on, you have a better chance of pushing through.
So I know you've had the chance to train in a few places, but I'd like to shift gears over to some of your role models, your martial arts inspirations. Who would you say was the most influential in setting you and keeping you on this martial arts path that has clearly brought you such wonderful experiences?
Well, as I talked earlier, it was my husband who dragged me to that first class. I'll have to give him credit for being instrumental in my martial arts upbringing, but not just because he dragged me to that first class. I mean, he was there with me when we trained. And I think I always felt comfortable knowing he was there. And even though we didn't train always together within the class itself, sometimes we were in different groups or whatnot. You know, we were able to practice at home and do things like that together. And he always encouraged me to continue. I often won trophies and things in the class tests, believe it or not. The places that I was so fearful to go, I would on occasion get a trophy for being, you know, the most focused or whatever, winning something. And he was just always backed me up. And for years, we trained together. And then when we received our black belts, and, you know, we are old school. We got our black belts back in, I'm trying to think, 1994. And then second degree in 1997. We did those together. I was pregnant when I tested for my first black belt. I was pregnant at the time. So we've been through a lot of experiences together. But beyond that, after that, we taught for our sensei. And then we started a program together at a low-income, high-risk community center for youth. And we taught there for a few reasons. One, we wanted to get some experience outside of our original dojo, something on our own, a program that we did on our own, to learn more about being good instructors. And these kids were kids that lived in a neighborhood in an area that was violent and crime ridden. They needed self-defense and they needed role models. And we taught there for 7 years for free. It was just something that happened and fell into place for us. And he was always instrumental in us doing these types of things because he loved martial arts as well. So many stories happened when we taught there. There was a brother and a sister whose caretaker, or their grandfather, went in for surgery and he passed away during the surgery. And they suddenly had no caretaker anymore. And so we actually considered adopting them. That's just how we felt about teaching. It really was a family, and we didn't want anybody to be separated, you know, brother and sister be separated or put into a foster home or be afraid. And fortunately, some family from out of the state finally came forward, but it was just an experience that we did together. And he's just always instrumental in pushing me along in my journey. He was the one who started our program that we teach now that said, hey, it's time again to do this. And that was 6 years ago. And so to this day, he still is very instrumental in what we do as martial artists and our family. And I'm just very grateful that worked out that way for us, because it's nice to have a spouse who has a similar mindset and loves martial arts too. And he's definitely a great motivator, supporter. I learn a lot from him. He is the main instructor in our program because I work full time and I'm not able to plan for it. So he plans it. And every time I go to a class to teach with him, I actually learn something, because he brings the new content to class. So He definitely gets the award for most instrumental in my upbringing.
And I'm going to speculate that being able to share this in your marriage has brought you closer.
Yes, I mean, it really, I would say it does. Although, when you have two, let me throw the caveat in there. When you have two people who are leaders, and you have two people who are very strong-willed, there's a lot of give and take that has to happen. For instance, when we are teaching, and he is the main instructor, I had to learn to step back. Because I would show up late because I'm driving from another area to get there. And I would come in and take over the class. And, you know, he had already prepared something. And, you know, so there was started to be some clashing. And I had to decide that, you know what, this is his class. I need to step back. He told me. We had a conversation about it. And so, you know, you have to, when you're both martial artists, you're both instructors, you've been doing it the same amount of time, you have to learn that only one can be the leader. So that's just a little quick lesson in marriage and martial arts.
Of course. And honestly, I had a feeling that you were going to offer that caveat because I've seen enough married couples teach and train together that that's usually how it goes down.
Right.
Now, you know, there's some great lessons to be learned from everything that we're hearing from you today and all these wonderful experiences. But hypothetically, if you could train with somebody that you haven't had the opportunity to before, be they alive or somebody that's passed on, who would that be?
Well, you know, I have so many. Being on social media and very active in social media, I just have so many martial arts friends and incredible instructors that are out there that I've never really met personally. So I'd like to chat about a few of them that, you know, they're not famous people. I'm not going to pick Bruce Lee or somebody really famous, even though they were fantastic role models and certainly very, very important. My martial art has always been very personal to me. I'm not a competitor and I'm not out to, you know, show how great I am, or I just want to work on my martial art and my life and keep them blended together in a positive way. So there are a few people who have been instrumental in my martial art thoughts and mindset, and I'd like to mention them today because I would like to teach with them, and I will someday teach with these people. But the first one, his name is Yao Sun Tong, and Yao Sun, I met him on Facebook or LinkedIn or one of those years ago. Yao Sun is he lives in Canada, but he's from China, and he's a Tai Chi practitioner. And I could use the word master. I don't know that he would accept that. I'm not sure if he goes by that, but he embodies Tai Chi. He lives and breathes it, really. It's the first time I ever met somebody like that. I always have an interest in Tai Chi, but didn't know a lot about it. When I met him and talked to him frequently, he explained how he practices and how personal Tai Chi is. It's different than other martial arts. You really, every person is so different in how they interpret it and practice it. And he practices it in Canada in the winter and the snow. He actually has clothes that he wears when it's cold that he wears outside when he does Tai Chi outside in the snow. And he's just, he's peaceful and he eats well. And he's just like one of those people that you look at and you think, I would love to just have a day with this person. And I've come so close on a few occasions to having a day with Yao Sun, but it hasn't worked out. I tried to schedule a seminar a year or two ago to get him down here to Florida to put on a seminar, and it kind of fell through at the last minute. Mm-hmm. And he was here in Florida to go on a cruise not long ago, and I still couldn't get over to see him. So I am going to meet Yao Sun Tong one day, and we are going to practice together, and I'm going to learn from him. Some of my newer friends are just so interesting and dynamic. Otto Dulas is in Austria, and Otto is a self-defense expert. He has several schools, and I'm not, these aren't even plugs for these people. I don't even know that I'm talking about them. they're just so important to me. And Otto is just so technically good at what he does. He teaches bodyguards, he teaches Krav Maga, he's got schools. But the thing about him, he's so much like me in many ways. He's got a very positive outlook. He's so kind and friendly, and all of his students look up to him like a brother. He's a young man in his early 30s, I believe. But he's just got a tremendous way of teaching that people love him. And being a woman, self-defense is so important to me. I know some, I've learned some, but I watch some of his videos and I watch some of the things that he does, and I'm so impressed. And so for those reasons, I'd like to train with Otto someday, I'd like to meet him. His positivity and his demeanor, his work ethic is just impeccable. I have a similar one. I'm a very hard worker. So when I see someone else who works so hard to help other people, and that's really what he does, that inspires me. And that's why I want to work with Otto. Another friend is Alex McGowan, and Alex lives in Scotland. And I met him really, you know, not too long ago, but he's the most incredible Taekwondo practitioner I personally have ever met and got to talk to. His flexibility is just incredible. And he's just so willing to teach others and to teach me. I can ask him any question. And I mean, he's sought out from people all over the world for his strength training and his martial art. And yet anytime I talk to him, he'll stop and make me a video and send it along to me so I can watch how to do something. He just reaches out to me whenever I need. But his Taekwondo is just so spectacular. I can't explain it any other way, but to look at him and think, that is really amazing. He's in my age range, and his work ethic is impeccable. So I would love to work with Alex one day.
Go ahead.
Yeah, they're all amazing. I mean, the list goes on. I have other people who support me daily. Arthur Collins, who's a friend up in Pennsylvania, who just sends me encouragement every day. He reminds me to work on my abs and to do my squat, you know. He's like, well, how many are you doing? Because I'm going to do as many, you know. Just little motivations. And he's a martial artist, so many. I guess the list could go on, but I'm just happy to be able to mention those few, because they're so important in my inspirational development. You know, I look at a martial artist and want to train with them, not because of what they do, but because of how they do it. And that's what I see when I look at these people, their willingness to help others, their positivity, their skills and techniques. So they're some of my favorites.
And those sound like great people. And I don't know any of those names, but listening to you talk about them, I certainly want to train with them myself. So
yeah, that's great. What I said. There's no famous people on my list. There's just real people. Yeah.
Without offering any disrespect to some of the famous people that have been on this show and some of whom that I have trained with, some of my favorite martial artists that I've trained with have been virtually unknown as well. So nothing wrong with picking people from that greater body of martial artists, because of course most of us aren't famous.
Right, exactly. And I don't personally know any of the famous ones. So, it's time I got to know some of those too.
Yeah. Well, keep plugging along and I'm sure some of them will appear if you want.
Yeah. Exactly.
So you've taken us on quite a journey through this episode, but you know, it's clear just from listening to you, even for a few minutes, that you've got a lot of self-motivation. So I'm wondering what's keeping you going. Are you goal-oriented? Are there goals, things that you're striving for as you move forward in the martial arts?
Yes, absolutely. I'm very goal-oriented. I'm very, I border a little bit on workaholic, so I have to watch myself because I'll take on a lot of projects. But my goals are many. My main degree that I have, my black belt, is in Tang Sudo, which was, I would say maybe it was altered a little bit. It was a little more Americanized than some, but basically that's what it is. But I haven't had an instructor in a long time, and it's difficult to find somebody who taught exactly what I learned now. So I'm now starting to train in Taekwondo, and this person that's teaching me, Grandmaster Michael Hadsel here in Florida, he reached out to me because I complained, I guess, one day on Facebook how I felt like a martial art orphan. It was very difficult for me to find a way to train anymore just based on my time and how busy my life is. And he kind of jumped in there and said, I will train you. I'll train you. If you want to learn Taekwondo, I know it's a little different style, but it's still Korean. I will train you. And so he's sort of taken me under his wing and is training me in that. And I've got a lot to learn. But it's really nice to be a student again. It's really nice. It's sort of like being a volunteer. If you've ever been a volunteer, you'll notice that same people volunteer all the time. It's sometimes nice if you're the volunteer. It's sometimes nice if you're the volunteer to be able to just go to the event or go to the place and not have to be the volunteer for a change. To me, that's sort of how being a student is. It's sort of nice not being the instructor. It's sort of nice to learn and not have to think about the other students or, you know, I love doing that, but it's just nice to practice myself again and work on my own skills and techniques, which is important. So that's one of my goals that I'm working on. Rank isn't important to me only in that it's important to other people. In order to validate yourself as a martial artist, sometimes you have to improve your rank to be seen for who you are. 26 years in the martial arts, I should be a higher rank, some people would think. Well, I just devoted myself to teaching all these years, and rank is not that important to me, but I know it's important to other people and to promote my own students. So that's why that's one of my goals.
One of the things that I can say, just to spider off of that and just validate that just a little bit more. One of the things that happens with this show is that, you know, before the interviews actually start, I have a few minutes, just as I did with you, speaking with these guests. And if you look through the guests that we've had some of the most prominent martial artists of our time come on this show, which I'm absolutely blown away by. But one of the things I will say is that there is almost an inverse relationship between someone's skill and prominence with their with the importance they place on both rank and title.
Mm-hmm.
There are, and I won't say who they are, but there are guests that I almost had to argue with because they wanted me to refer to them by their first name only, without any kind of title. And some of those people ended up with Mr. or Mrs. or something else. And so I won't say who it was. I'll let all of you speculate, but there's
Okay.
absolutely nothing wrong with 26 years in the martial arts and having any rank on any end of the spectrum, because
Yeah.
regardless of how many stripes are on your belt, even whether there are stripes or not, doesn't change what you can do.
That's very true. It's very true.
Sorry for stealing Thank the spotlight for a minute, but
no, no, please. So some of my other goals. Okay. We didn't talk about my writing, but I am a martial arts writer. I started doing that a couple of years ago. I decided to put my martial arts thoughts, both inspirational and actual martial art training stuff, and combine those with my other passion, which has always been writing. And writing was one of those things that I didn't have confidence about, even though I was always a writer. I've always been a writer. Didn't have the confidence to ever do anything with it until a couple of years ago when another martial artist told me, and he's a blogger, and he said, he said, I looked for you on Google and everything, and I couldn't find anything about you. And I said, no, why would you find anything about me there? And he said, because you're such a good writer and a martial artist, why aren't you doing something with that? So I started the blog a couple of years ago. And my sole intent with the blog was just to reach out. And it's called Winning at Life. It's just really about martial arts and how you can apply it to your life. Whether it's a mindset or whether you're a martial artist or not, here's some positive things that you should know about yourself that you don't know. All the things that I've learned about myself over all these years that took me, all these hard lessons that I learned, I'm able to share those with other people and say, look, this is how you apply this to your life. So I started the blog and was hopeful that I'd have a reader or two. And it took a little bit of time to get it going. But now, you know, in a month time or a few weeks, there's thousands of people who read the blog. And it's just, it blows me away, because I always wonder, why does anybody want to read what I'm writing? And I know why. I know why. It's because I'm genuine. It's because they see me as a friend. It's because of these experiences that I've been through that they can relate. That's what it is. It's the real me, and people get to see someone else who struggles and someone else who has, you know, bad times, but that person is able to persevere and pull through. And if she can do it, I can do it. That's one of my mottos. If, you know, I try to tell people, if I can do it, you can do it. If I'm 52 years old, I'm still doing all this stuff, and I'm happy about it, you can do it. So the blog has helped. A little bit before the blog, I had sent in my first query letter to write in a magazine, and it was the magazine called MA Success. It's for the Martial Arts Industry Association. I saw a little advertisement in there that always said writers wanted or whatever. So I finally got up enough nerve to send in a query, and they accepted it. They wrote me back and said, yes, write the article. So I was thrilled and scared and everything at the same time, because it had never been published. Wrote the article about, I believe that first one was about teaching martial arts in a rural community, because I live in a rural community. And so I wrote that, and you know, that really opened a door for me to thinking about magazines. And since then, my goals now are always about writing, about combining martial arts and writing and inspiring other people. I'm a writer for the World Martial Arts Magazine. I highlight other martial artists in there, and I also write a sort of inspirational article myself every month. So I'm a monthly columnist for that. And I write for Conflict Manager. I write about defense, self-defense there. I write for my local newspaper. So now I'm writing for several magazines and my book. The book is called The Martial Arts Woman. It's going to be published this year. I've been working on it for probably 7 or 8 months. It's one of my biggest goals, because I've been published in magazines many times now, and the book is something amazing. I think it's never really been done this way. Don't think there's another book like it. It's called The Martial Arts Woman. It's about women, obviously, but it's not about what kind of training they've had or what degree they are or how many schools they own or where they teach or where they practice. It's not really about any of that. What it's about is the psyche and the mindset of the martial arts woman, how she applies martial arts to her life, how she, just like the story I told you about the pregnancy, there's a few stories like that in there. There's stories about being a fighter for those women who are fighters. There's three cancer journeys in there about women who are martial artists and have cancer and how they apply martial arts to that. And each one of them has a different way of doing it. There's just all different stories, different writers, different martial artists that many people are familiar with. Karen Eden Herdman, Joy Turberville, Rosita De Jesus, Michelle Manu. There's a huge list. Dana Hee. There's about 25 women, some who are just what I consider myself an everyday martial artist. Some are everyday martial artists telling their stories. So it's really a beautiful book about many stories and insights and gives people finally the chance to see what it is the female martial artist thinks about what, how she lives, why it's so important to her. These are just like personal stories or stories about how they decided to learn a martial art. They're just really amazing stories. And each chapter is standalone where you can just read a chapter and learn something about a woman. And I've written the bulk of the book myself. So there are topics in there that I've chosen to write about. The pregnancy story that I told you is one of them, but there's another that is an interesting story as well. And then I also talk about why women stop training. My idea is why. I also talk about different things that I've seen myself over the years. What kind of commitment a woman makes with a martial art, or how she's a mother and applies martial arts. So all of those kinds of things are in the book. So that's my biggest goal, is to finally get this big thing published this year and get it out there so everybody can read it. And I'll just say it's not a book for men or women or martial artists or not. It's a book for all of those people. It's got an inspirational tone that I think anybody can read and enjoy and learn something about. So that's the big goal.
Well, certainly with the stories that you're sharing here today, I'm looking forward to reading it, and I'm sure anyone that's going to listen to the episode will be interested in the book. So, of course, please, once it's published, let us know. We'll let everybody else know. We'll probably even update the show notes for this episode over on the website, whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. Of course, I haven't said that yet this episode. We are going to have links, because you sent me links and to all these things that you're talking about, your blog and the places that you're writing, so people can follow you and learn more about you and what's going on with you and, you know, get a sense maybe of your writing style in anticipation of the book,
right?
Which is really exciting. Yeah. I mean, there aren't enough martial arts books out there. I wish there were more. So I'm glad that you're writing one. And
yeah, I'm glad too.
Yeah. So I don't want to cut you off if there's more on the that front where you're writing and where people can follow you and learn more about you.
No, I mean, there's not really more. If you could share the links, I invite people to connect with me on Facebook. One of my Facebook sites, you do have to request, send a friend request, and I'll generally accept. The other one is for The Martial Arts Woman, and you can just like that page if you're interested. And the blog, I'll just go ahead and throw that out now.
Please,
people,
yeah.
www.themartialartswoman.com. So as you can see, and I didn't mention this earlier, but the name of my blog is called The Martial Arts Woman. And over time, I started to become known as The Martial Arts Woman. And now the book is being called The Martial Arts Woman. So you see them there.
You're consistent with your branding. That's a good thing.
There you go. People will remember. They might not remember Andrea Harkins, but they will remember the martial arts woman.
That's right. Wonderful. So I really appreciate you being here today. And I'm wondering if you have any parting words of wisdom for all of us.
My parting words of wisdom are: apply a martial art mindset to your life each and every day. And if you don't know what that is, just start with positivity. Just start with learning self-confidence, believing in yourself, because I believe in you. That's all there is to it, really. If you need someone to believe in you, I believe in you. And I know that you can do whatever that you want to do. Be empowered and go forward in your life. Take risks and reach out and do all of the things. Don't let fear stop you from your purpose or from your mission.
Thank you for listening to episode 55 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio. And thank you to Sensei Andrea for your time and your stories. Head on over to whistlekickmartialartsradio.com for the show notes with links to everything we talked about today, including links to all of Sensei Andrea's writings, photos, and her website. If you like the show, please subscribe or download one of the apps so you never miss out on a new episode. And if we could trouble you to leave us a review wherever you download your podcast, we'd appreciate it. We've been getting some great 5-star ratings, but the reviews have been a bit light lately. Remember, if we read your review on the air, just contact us and we'll get you a free pack of Whistlekick stuff. If you want to be a guest on the show, or you know someone that would be a great interview, please fill out the form on the website. And don't forget to subscribe to our newsletter so you can stay up on everything we do. Please follow us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, and Instagram, all with the username Whistlekick. And remember, the products we make here at Whistlekick, like our great hats, those whole bunch more, over at whistlekick.com. So, until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day.